Good afternoon, and welcome to Gardens of California. If this is your first time viewing the show, let me tell you a little bit about myself and the show. This is a live podcast, and it's interactive. You can call in with your questions about your garden, whether it be about a certain type of plant material, or pest control, or just general information about how to take care of a garden or a landscape. I am a plant pathologist, and just to give you a little bit about my background, I went to Camp Pompomona, where I got an undergraduate degree in botany, and I went to UCR, where I got a PhD in plant pathology, working on citrus root rot. And then I worked at the Huntington. I curated the committee collection there for a few years. I worked at the Arboretum of Los Angeles County, where I was a research horticulturalist. And for the last 11 years, I've been with the Los Angeles County Agricultural Commissioner's Office, Department of Ways and Measures, as the senior biologist, plant pathologist. In the last couple of years, I've been teaching this class as well. And as I said, this is a class about gardens. And we talk about everything from trees to turf and apples to zinnias. So if there's a plant material you're having a problem with in your garden, or if there's something you're interested in growing, give us a call. And I'll do my best to answer your questions. Our number is 1-800-339-1193. This is, of course, a class at Cal State Dominguez Hills, and we use for our textbook, or our reference text, the Sunset Western Garden Book. And if you are a beginning gardener, or even if you're an experienced gardener, this should really be the first book in your library on gardening. It really is an excellent text. It's an encyclopedia of plants, plus it has some additional sections. At the beginning of the book, it has sections on plant uses, such as plants that go well in rock gardens, or plants for herbicides, or plants that attract hummingbirds, things like that. And at the back of the book, it has a lot of sections on pest control, and pruning, and fertilizing, and things of that nature. So I often refer to this book myself, quite frequently, when I want to read about a particular genus, or species, or plant family, and reflect my memory, or learn something new. So that's our text. And I will try and show you books over the next coming months as we explore gardens in California and how to take care of them. So today we're going to talk about diseases that kill trees and plants. We have some very famous historical diseases, and they have caused enormous problems for the United States, not actually just the United States, but all over the world, depending on the disease you're talking about. So let's start with our first disease, and many of you have probably heard of chestnut blight. And chestnut blight was a devastating epidemic that occurred at the beginning of the 1900s, and it was introduced probably between 1900 and 1908. It is a canker disease. Now, a canker is an infection in a branch or the wood of the trunk. And usually, the canker can be an area on the trunk that shrinks back and cracks. It may bleed or gum. The fungus or the bacteria that's causing the canker may reproduce in the canker. In this particular case, chestnut blight is caused by a fungus called Craphonectria parasitica. It used to be, the name used to be Endothia parasitica, but they, I think taxonomists actually changed the name on us all the time, so it got changed. It infects American chestnuts, and the blight fungus moves from tree to tree as spores on feet, fur, and feathers of the many animals and insects that walk across the canker, and that's particularly important about birds, actually. The sexual spores of the fungus are actually called ascospores, because this fungus is an ascomycete, and that is one of the large groups of fungi, the higher fungi. These sexual spores are shot into the air after rain, these ones in the fall and are another source of infection. Rickettsias was accidentally introduced into North America, either through imported chestnut lumber or through imported chestnut trees from Japan or China. Now, their native chestnuts are highly resistant to this disease. The American chestnut, unfortunately, is highly susceptible. But by 1940, mature American chestnut trees were virtually wiped out across the eastern seaboard by chestnut blight. And in some places, such as the Appalachian Mountains and others, it is estimated that one in every four hardwoods was an American chestnut. The point of that is that chestnuts were the dominant tree species in much of the eastern United States. They were the most important lumber species, and the chestnuts themselves, the fruit, was an important food source for native animals. Mature trees grew to a height of greater than 50 feet, up to 100 feet in height, and they had very straight trunks, often branch-free for 50 feet of trunking, and the trunk diameters could be in excess of 5 feet. So these were massive trees, and very, very important trees. They were, as I said earlier, just a moment ago, the number one timber species at that time of in our history. And for really for three centuries, most barns and homes east of the Mississippi were made from American chestnut. The discovery of chestnut bright fungus on some Asian chestnut trees planted on Long Island in New York was made public in 1904, and within 40 years, the near 4 billion strong American chestnut population in Northern America was wiped out. Now, it doesn't kill the root system, and so what will happen is when you get the canker on the tree and it girdles it and kills the tree, because that's actually what's happening, is that girdle gets bigger and bigger and girdles the tree and kills it, is it will sever from the base, and you get all these shoots coming up from the base. So those shoots will then get infected, and they'll die back. But that just is a continuous process. So you can go find these infected chestnuts, and they're still there, but they never make any fruit or chestnuts, and they never get big enough to be practical for any type of lumber. So it basically killed them and wiped them out. So we call these kind of living stumps from sturgles. And so there are a large number of those that exist as kind of a dead, pulled back stump and a bunch of shoots. And as I mentioned, the Japanese and some Chinese chestnut species are resistant. They may be infected, but the blight is not usually killing. So that's a good source of resistance for breeding for plant breeders, and that is a continuous effort here in the United States to breed in resistance from the Asian species so we can reestablish American chestnuts in the United States. The root power of the root system of the tree are fairly resistant to the blight, so that's why it doesn't move down and kill the roots. But the shoots will not grow and reproduce before the blight attacks them. So this was a devastating introduction, not just environmentally, but also financially, because it was such an important economic species. In 1912, the Plant Quarantine Act was passed to reduce the chances of this catastrophe happening again. And I believe that was probably one of the first, if not the first, plant quarantines created in the United States, and now today we have literally hundreds of quarantines. A large number of grafted and seeding Japanese chestnuts were imported in 1900, and it was clear that disease nursery stock was the most important factor in the spread of the chestnut blight. In 1965, an interesting occurrence, biologically speaking, there were hypovirulent strains of the blight fungus from Italy were discovered, and these hypovirulent, which means they are less virulent, they are less pathogenic, would not kill those chestnut trees in Italy and in Europe in general. And in fact, that this hypovirulence could be transferred from one infected tree to another infected tree, and the tree would actually recover. And so you can inoculate these strains of the hypovirulent types of the chestnut black fungus. And into these existing cankers, and it resulted in a canker remission. And this is really an interesting subject within pathology and biology or mycology, where mycology, the study of fungi, meets botany, or the study of plants and trees. And what happened is that this is actually a virus infection of the fungus. So by taking one of these hypovirulent strains from a tree that is surviving well and was infected, and inoculating it into a tree with a virulent strain, you actually transfer the virus into that fungus in that tree, and then those trees will experience remission and can recover. That has not worked real well in terms of trying to control the disease in North America. It works pretty well in Europe, and they've gotten some rather good results in Europe, but here in the United States, it has not been as effective. I don't want to go into too much detail, but not all the strains are compatible. So sometimes you'll take a fungus from one canker and try and get that virus to transmit into the other canker, and the two strains of the fungi in the different trees, they won't grow together, so you don't get that transmission. And it gets to be rather complicated in terms of the genetics. But after about 4 or 5 years, the hypovirulent strains did spread through the chestnut orchards of France, and the trees began healing. So these blighted cankers, or the cankers in the fungus would actually pass over, and this established a biological control. There is no other control. There are no chemicals that can control this. And if we can bring up this picture full screen, we'll take a look at one of the cankers, and what you can see is here's the canker itself, and then if we go to number three, and you can see this is actually the sporulation of the fungus. These are called pycnidia, right in here, and this is where the spores are being produced within the canker, and these are the spores that will get on birds, and the birds will fly off and transmit the spores for miles and miles. And in fact, when this chestnut blight first happened, there was an attempt to cut down a big swath of chestnut trees and to prevent the spread, and of course that wasn't effective. The birds spread the spores quite effectively for miles. I do want to remind everybody out there that we are live and on the air, and our number is 800-339-1193. So give us a call if you have a question about your garden, and or a question about a dead tree in your garden. Because today we're talking about diseases that kill trees. Now if we bring up the fourth picture, you can see what happens to a fungus at full screen. This is a canker that's healed over. So here's the canker, and it's calloused over in here. All in here, it's calloused over. So this is a hypovirulent canker, and the tree will survive even though it's been infected. And let's take a look at our fifth photograph and bring this up full screen. This is the natural range in the eastern United States of the American chestnut. And it's really staggering to think that every one of these trees in this enormous range was killed. But that's what happens when you introduce an exotic pest into an environment, habitat, and the susceptible species has no resistance at all. And we've seen this repeatedly, not just with fungal diseases of trees, we see it with insects that are introduced into North America and can devastate our native tree species or devastate our urban forests. And so the United States Department of Agriculture and the California Department of Food and Agriculture and all of your county agricultural commissioner offices, one of our sole responsibilities is to try and prevent the introduction of new exotic pests into California or into Los Angeles County. They come in predominantly through commerce, through the shipment of plant materials or agricultural products. They can also come in from a variety of other ways. It all depends on the past. Some of you may not know this, but gypsy moth was introduced into the New England area many, many years ago. But it lays its eggs on furniture outdoors. And it's one of the places you can find the egg masses. And so if you move from the East Coast to California or to the West Coast, and you bring with you outdoor furniture, when you arrive, the county you arrive in will go out and inspect your furniture for egg masses for gypsy moth, because we don't have gypsy moth in California, and we don't want it. They do have gypsy moth. The caterpillars from the moth itself is pretty harmless. But the caterpillars in defoliating the forest. So, I think I saw a brief question, where would we see this disease in California? Well, you know, I can see chestnuts blight in California. We don't grow chestnuts in California. You might be able to get away with growing one here because the disease may not be established, but other than that. Now, so that's chestnut blight. So there is a breeding program to try and take the resistant Asian species, the Japanese and Chinese species, and breed them, you know, cross them with our Native American chestnut. And then you continually back cross and back cross and back cross until you get predominantly, like, you know, it's 99% genetically, it's an American chestnut, but it's picked up that resistance gene, so those genes that confer resistance. And then you're able to grow an American chestnut that's resistant to the blight. That's the current status. That, you know, we still have the disease. It was introduced over 100 years ago. It's still a big problem for us, and that's why it's really important not to smuggle in anything from international sources. If you're traveling internationally, please don't bring back cuttings or plant materials unless they've been inspected and found to be free of insects and diseases and other problems that they can come. You know, it's just over and over again we see this. Somebody brings back a cutting from Central America, maybe a cutting of avocado because they're an avocado grower or an enthusiast, and they don't realize it. There's some very small eggs on that cutting, and that's how avocado thrips was introduced into California, from cuttings that were smuggled in from Central America. And we can keep going down the list of many of these exotic pests. So the take-home message in today's show is don't smuggle plant materials, because it can really hurt the economy. It can devastate home growers because, you know, backyard growers, you know, in your own garden, in the back of your home, you really don't have the tools that a farm or, you know, agriculture has to control some of these diseases. And often there are no tools, and we just have to stand by and watch a particular species die out. Now, the other really spectacular epidemic that occurred here in the United States was Dutch elm disease. And this was the American elm. And it was introduced into North America on lumber in 1928. And again, it's a similar story. The actual name of the fungus is Ophiostoma. And it is endemic to the Western Himalayas, and it is an extremely virulent species. It is vectored by beetles. There are now considered to be three species of Ophiostoma that are important in Dutch elm disease. It was first described in Europe in North America in the 1940s. It has devastated elms in both areas. It pretty much wiped out the American elm throughout the Midwest of the United States. And the native elm bark beetle is one of the vectors, and the European elm bark beetle is also a vector. And what these beetles do is they land on a tree, and they burrow into the tree a little bit and lay their eggs, and they've got the fungus on them, because when they left the tree that they were that they grew up in, they got the fungus on them. And so when they leave that tree, they've got the fungus on them, they go to another tree, they burrow in, they lay their eggs. The eggs then hatch into small grubs or larvae and feed between the bark and the wood. And I'll bring this picture up full screen. This is called a beetle gallery. And the eggs would be laid right in here. And then as they hatch, the larvae feed like this. So these are called beetle galleries, and you can see all these lines. This is where the grubs, and you can see here, these are all places where the beetles lay their eggs. The beetles actually eat the fungus as it grows in the tree. They eat the tree, they eat a little bit of wood, but they're also eating a lot of the fungus. And it's said that every bark beetle has a fungus associated with it that grows in these galleries or grows in the wood. And then the beetle actually, these grubs actually eat the fungus. Now, Dutch elm disease was actually first noticed in Europe as early as 1910. The first strain was relatively mild. It only killed a small portion of elms, more often killing scattered branches, and had largely died out by the 1940s. In 1967, a new, far more virulent strain arrived in Britain on a shipment of rock elm logs from North America, and this strain proved both highly contagious and lethal to all of the European native elms. More than 25 million trees died in the United Kingdom alone. So as I said, these epidemics don't occur just in the United States, they occur worldwide. First reported in the United States in 1928, as I mentioned earlier, with the beetles believed to have arrived in a shipment of logs from the Netherlands, destined for use as veneer in Ohio. So, once we got the beetle and the fungus, that was pretty much it. It's very, very difficult, if not impossible, to eradicate an insect once it's established in an environment. If you bring in a little tiny insect and it starts reproducing, and those agricultural inspectors or foresters or people out there looking for these bugs, they're not likely to find them for a year or several years. And by the time you find them, they're established over a large area. So it's really interdiction and prevention is our only hope, because once they're established, we're behind an eight ball, to say the least. So, this disease, the Dutch elm disease, has spread slowly from New England westward and southward, almost completely destroying the elms of Elm City of New Haven, reaching the Detroit area in 1950, Chicago by 1960, and Minneapolis by 1970. This is really a modern epidemic. It occurred in our lifetimes. The chestnut blight was a little before my time. It is primarily spread by three different ways. And by beetle vectors that carry the fungus from tree to tree, through direct contacts of infected tree's roots with a neighboring healthy tree, and by pruning of a healthy tree with saws, which have been used to take down diseased trees. And that's actually another common way to move diseases from plant to plant is on your pruning tools. I see we have our first caller. Let's go to our first caller. David, calling from Los Angeles. You're on the air.
Good afternoon. I have a question. I have several citrus trees that I recently planted, yesterday I was listening to the radio about reports of problems with citrus trees that they were having in the Indian River in Florida, which some of the commercial groves were devastated by disease. Is that something we have to write about here?
Well, I didn't hear your entire question, but I think I know what you're talking about. There are two diseases in Florida that are devastating the Florida citrus industry. One of them is a very old disease, it's citrus canker, and the other one is fairly, in terms of introduction in the United States, it's a fairly new disease, citrus greening. We do not have either of those diseases in California, so that's the good news. Now, with citrus canker was a huge problem. And was introduced into the southern United States, into Florida, and throughout the South in the 1920s, and the United States Department of Agriculture had an eradication program, literally cut down millions, tens of millions of citrus trees across the South, and declared it eradicated. It took, I think, about 15 years, and they declared it eradicated, but the citrus canker reappeared during the 1970s in citrus nurseries in Florida. And then it started showing up in people's backyards, on backyard citrus trees, and it started showing up in orchards. They started another quarantine, another eradication program. But then there were some hurricanes that blew it from one end of the state to the next, and USDA gave up on citrus canker in Florida. Now, the other disease is citrus breathing. And it is an even more serious disease and more devastating. Now, citrus canker is a bacterial disease. Citrus breathing is also a bacterial disease, but it is a vascular disease. It is inside the water conducting tissue of the plant, of the citrus tree. And it is moved from plant to plant by a small insect called the citrus Asian psyllid. And so in 1997, the citrus Asian psyllid was discovered in Florida. And in about 2002 or so, they found trees infected with citrus green in Florida. And since that date, they've lost 60,000 acres of citrus in Florida to citrus green. That's equal to all the citrus we grow in California. So it's a tremendous amount of acreage to lose to a disease. About a year or two ago, I don't remember my exact dates, the citrus Asian psyllid, which is the vector for the disease, not the disease itself, was found in Tijuana and then immediately after in San Diego. Since then, it's been found in Orange County, LA County, and now Ventura County in parts of Arizona. So the psyllid itself is pretty harmless, but it can acquire the bacteria from an infected tree and move it to another tree. So it is a quarantined pest. It's a regulated pest. So the answer is, we don't have citrus breeding. And if we did, it would be a horrible development. Now, the history is that normally after you get the psyllid, after some period of time, you end up getting the disease. But Hawaii has had the psyllid now for a long time, and they still don't have any trees with citrus breeding. So right now, there's nothing to worry about in terms of citrus greening or citrus canker. Citrus canker is a bacterial disease that gets on the leaves and the fruit and the twigs, and it really needs a very wet climate, wet and warm. It just probably would never really do well here in California because we're so dry. But greening would be a devastating disease if it were introduced in California. So does that answer your question?
Thank you. I just have one more question.
Okay.
The question is this. In the same program I was listening to, they talked about some special eating orange that was highly valued that was grown there. Is this something that's an even better or more prized eating orange than the usual ones that are sold here?
Well, actually, I will be doing a lecture on citrus coming up in weeks ahead. There are many varieties of citrus, and the medieval orange, of course, sparked the entire industry in California in the 1890s. The Washington navel was the first navel grown and first one was discovered in Brazil. Cuttings were taken in Washington, it was grown in Washington, it was sent to a woman named Elizabeth Thibbets in Riverside, California, two trees, and that was the basis of the navel orange industry in California. That Washington navel is a wonderful navel. I've one in my backyard. It's sweet, it's a nice thick skin, it's easy to peel, and it's seedless, and so that really sparked the industry. My favorite oranges are blood oranges, either like I'm trying to think the two varieties that I like the best. There are two or three varieties of bloods that I think are the best oranges you can eat. But there are also now many, many other varieties of navel besides Washington, and they're all quite good. I have a lot of people tell me their favorite varieties, and I just find most of these varieties to be excellent. But the Moro blood is a really wonderful orange. If you want oranges year round, then you can grow a navel and a Valencia, because the Valencias will ripen in the summer and the navels will ripen in the winter. So, offhand, I don't know of any super variety that would stand out. Okay? I see we have another caller. Let's go to our next caller. Terry, calling from South Pasadena. Welcome back to the show.
Hi, I had a comment, really. I was thinking, don't you think it's awful that they cut down all those trees below the Santa Anita Dam in Arcadia?
Well, I would have to agree with you 100% that that was awful. I've been following that story now for several weeks, and if the other viewers aren't familiar with this story, there was an area out in Arcadia, that's about maybe 5 to 10 acres. It had about 175 or so California coastline oak and about 75 western sycamores. And the area had been designated nearly 60 years ago as an area to spread the silt and the rocks and gravel that have to be dug out from behind the Santa Anita Dam. Well, here we are. It's a mature grove. These are trees are in excess of 100 years old. It was a popular area for people to hike. And about a month ago, they put a 30-day hold on cutting down those trees to look for alternatives. Unfortunately, the Los Angeles County Board of Supervisors felt that it was more important to prevent trucks driving through Arcadia than to save 175 oaks and 75 sycamores.
Oh, that's terrible.
My opinion is shame on the board, shame on the Department of Public Works for butchering 175 California coastal oaks, for butchering and murdering sycamore trees. These trees are far more important than how many trucks drive through Arcadia for a year or two.
I agree.
I'm shocked about the hypocrisy that the Board of Supervisors exhibited, because we have a very strict oak preservation ordinance in Los Angeles County. It places a large burden on our property owners and our homeowners, and I agree with that ordinance, and I think we should have a burden to save our oak trees, to save our native trees, and I don't think we should cut down hundreds of them for a short-term benefit. Those trees took more than 100 years to grow, and they won't be back for another 100 years. And I would like to invite all of our listeners to call in and comment about the destruction of that oak woodland. It was despicable. There were alternatives, and they should not have been cut down.
Well, that's what I wanted to comment on.
Well, thank you for calling.
Okay.
And I agree with you 100%. We need to preserve our open lands. We need to preserve our native trees. And we shouldn't be cutting down oak trees so that we can drive trucks a little less. I think we might have another caller. Let's go to our next caller. Gus calling from South Pasadena. You're on the air.
Hi. I enjoy your show very, very much, and I'm learning a whole lot. And my question is, I grew a tree from a seedling about a year and a half ago. It's now about 5.5 feet tall. And during the time we had to spell with the cold and the rain, most of the leaves withered. So I cut them off, and there's some little sprouts back. But I don't know what to do. I covered it with a plastic over them. And what is your suggestion for that?
Oh, what type of tree is it?
It's a papaya.
Oh, papaya. Okay. Papaya grow rapidly from seed. And they are tender, so they can freeze back in a cold. We had some pretty cold weather a few weeks ago.
Yeah.
So that probably froze them back a little bit. The general recommendation for dealing with trees after frost damage is wait till spring to prune them back so that you can see the extent of the frost, of the freeze damage. Because right now, you won't know how much of the tree really froze until it flushes with new growth in the spring.
It already has new growth on the top. They're about maybe 1.5 to 2 inches tall. Little leaves coming, very, very bright green. But the longer leaves, you know, with the big, with the large stems, all of those, they got flaccid. They just collapsed.
Yeah, they froze.
They were like dry.
Yeah, the pie is pretty tender.
And I left the little sprouts on top, but I cover them with a plastic, because I think I saw Martha Stewart a long time ago that she had to cover things when you have severe cold.
Yeah, okay, so what you want to do is if we're going to have temperatures approaching 32 degrees, or if we have a predicted frost for the San Gabriel Valley, then you can go out and cover it with plastic, but you need to cover it all the way to the ground and then put some dirt on it and seal it to the ground. The other thing you can do, and this is true of any trees that are tender and you're afraid of frost, because if you've got a hard enough frost, you know, citrus will freeze, or avocados will freeze. And of course, if they're real big trees, it's difficult. But you can actually put a light bulb you know, stretch out an extension cord and plug a light bulb in and hang it inside the tree, and then put a tarp over that, and that light bulb will get off quite a bit of heat, plenty of heat, in order to prevent the frost damage. So that's one trick you can use to prevent frost damage, but often just the tarp alone is sufficient. But it does need to come all the way down to the ground, and you have to kind of seal it. The reason this works is because at night, the ground gives off heat. And so you trap that heat that's being given off by the soil, and that will keep the tree from freezing. You don't have to do it on nights when it's going to stay, say, above 45 or even above 40. And we had recent warm nights just a few weeks ago, in the last week or so, where it only got down to about 51 or 52. Very, very warm for a winter night in Southern California. So you don't have to do it every night, just on the nights that they predict frost or you know it's going to dip down into the 30s. And I would have to look up papaya and see what its frost tolerance is. Some plants are damaged below 50 degrees, but I think papaya should be able to take up to about 40. That's a guess. I'm not exactly sure.
Right.
But, yeah, and target, well, hang on.
The plastic?
Yeah, you want to use like a 2 mil or a 4 mil plastic, maybe. The other thing that also prevents frost damage is flooding, because as the water freezes, it gives off heat as well. That's more of an agricultural trick than it is effective for homeowners. The other thing is when you grow tender materials in your garden, you know, we grow a lot of tender materials, a lot of tropicals, like hibiscus and bougainvillea. And so if you're growing things that are tender, growing them close to your home will actually protect them as well, because your house gives off a lot of heat at night. So things that are right up against your house will freeze last. And so it's got to get a lot colder to freeze something up against the house. Whereas something out in the open, you know, 30, 40, 50 feet from your house and out in the open with, you know, no trees near it, those will freeze first. Now, the papayas should give you fruit within about 9 months. And, in fact, there was a really serious disease in papaya that limited their production in Hawaii and Taiwan, and it became an annual crop, which is a funny thing to think of. But papayas literally in Taiwan were for a while. They would grow them, they'd get up and make a crop, and then this virus disease, which was called papaya ring spot, would actually kill the tree, and then they'd replant. Well, now they've got some techniques to control that disease, and you can grow your papayas for many years. But that's interesting. You're growing papaya in South Pass. Congratulations, and good luck. And I admire people who kind of stretch the limits of their garden.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you for your call. So I don't know if I need to get up on my soapbox and beat the drum too much, but I've done shows on oaks. I've had some of our oak advocates here as guests. Rosie Daggett is a strong advocate for oaks in the Santa Monica Mountains. I had her on the show, and I was shocked that the Los Angeles County Department of Public Works cut down the trees. It was shocking, and it was not justified. So let's talk about fungal diseases that kill trees rather than chainsaws and people who kill trees. And we were talking about Dutch elm disease. We were talking about how it's vectored. It's vectored by beetles and by root grafts and by pruning equipment, which is also a common thread. Excuse me. There, of course, is an effort to develop resistant American elm cultivars, and there are a number of resistant cultivars now available. And these can either be selected from the natural population, the wild population. If you go out and there's a forest and all the trees die but one, well, that one is resistant, so you can propagate from that one. Of course, typically you'll find more than one. That's been used in a lot of different species that have serious diseases. So there's three different cultivars. There's Princeton. This was selected in 1922 by Princeton Nurseries for its landscape merit. By happy coincidence, this cultivar was revealed to be highly resistant in an inoculation study in the early 1990s. And mature trees planted in the 1920s still survive. And so it's a wonderful American elm species, the coastal bar Princeton. There's also Valley Forge, which has demonstrated resistance to Dutch elm disease, and another variety called Lewis and Clark, which is the latest cultivar to be released in 2004, which is cloned from a tree growing in North Dakota that has survived unscathed when all around has succumbed to the disease. And that's actually, you know, that's just taking advantage of nature. We go out there, and if a disease has been introduced into the forest, it's devastating the forest, then out of a natural population of millions of trees, some individuals should be resistant. And then we can utilize that resistance, that natural resistance, and reforest or save the species. It doesn't always happen, but it can happen, and it's happened many times. So those are two historic epidemics of exotic introduced fungal diseases that have wiped out Native American trees. And so it is my full-time job during the week to try and help prevent the introduction of these types of diseases. So I probably jump up my soapbox again in a minute. But let's talk about another disease that starts a little closer to home. It is a disease that attacks a wide variety of trees, but here in Southern California, we call it the oak root rot fungus. We call it that because it naturally occurs on oak trees in California, but it has a very wide host range. And it can attack literally thousands of different species. Now, historically, all you can see these armaria mushrooms up on this picture, and you can see the dead stump in the back. And here's the clump of mushrooms. Here's some, might as well talk a little bit about the characteristics of the fungus itself. We call these mushrooms gregarious in that they all the stems are united at the base. You see all the down here, they're all united. This one doesn't show some of the other characteristics, but we'll show you some more in a moment. Historically, Armillaria, the genus, was considered to only be one species for all North America. This goes back to the 60s and the 70s. Then it became apparent, and there were proponents who said, oh, no, there's many more species. Of course, everybody who says something new is boo-pooed and dismissed initially until years later they're proved correct. So now it's accepted that there's 11 species of Armillaria in North America. On the East Coast, this fungus is known as the shoestring fungus, and I'll tell you why in a minute. It infects almost any woody host. There are some very, very resistant species. So if you have this in your garden, as I do in my garden in Pasadena, and Pasadena is a hot spot for Armillaria, I grow resistant plants as much as possible, and some of the most resistant are ginkgo trees. The ficus and eucalyptus are considered resistant. I found Bergmansia, which is a Asia's trumpet, that is doing quite well in my garden. Avocados are considered highly resistant, and that's my experience, they are. There are no chemical treatments for this. If a tree becomes infected with it, all you can do is try and keep the soil dry. Nothing is more important than how you irrigate your landscape, and especially in terms of disease control and soil-borne diseases. By keeping the soil wet, by watering too frequently, you encourage the disease, you create a soil environment that's conducive to the disease, rather than trying to create an environment that suppresses the disease. So you suppress the Armillaria by not watering too frequently, and so for large shade trees, what you want to do is, for the most part, they only need to be watered once a month. You deep soak them once a month, and that's kind of how you try and control Armillaria. Now, Armillaria is a mushroom-forming fungus, as you saw those mushrooms there, but let's look at another picture of mushrooms. Let's look at number 8, which are these, bring these up full screen. This picture I took at the Huntington Botanical Gardens. Now, as I mentioned, the San Gabriel Valley is a hot spot for Armillaria. I've also seen it a lot out in the Beverly Hills area, but I've seen it virtually everywhere in Southern California at some point in time. But here are the mushrooms. It's a large, they form in clumps, sometimes hundreds. The gills, here's the gill surface in here. The gills run down the stem a little bit. That's called being decurrent. And there's a ring or on the stem. This, you can call it a stem or a stipe. And here is the ring or the annulus. It's very high up and very close to the cap. And the spark rent is a creamy white. And the spark rent is the first means, or the first way you identify a mushroom. You cut the cap off right there, and then you put that mushroom on a piece of paper and cover it up in a bowl. And the spores are shot off your gills, and you collect on the paper. And in this case, they will be a creamy white, as the colors of mushrooms can vary anywhere from snowy white, creamy white, to yellow, to lavender, to green, to brown, to dark brown, to black, to purple black. But these are creamy white. The other thing identifies them is they can come up the trunk. The fungus can come up the trunk and cause a bleeding canker. And we'll take a look at number 10 and show you a bleeding canker on a tree I diagnosed many years ago. Let's bring this up full screen. Here you can see the dummy. This is actually sap oozing out in here, right in these areas. And this is the canker. And when I chopped into it, let's go to number 11. And when I chopped into it, this is what you find. This is called a mycelial fan. Right here is the mycelial fan. This is a thin layer of fungal tissue that you find between the bark and the wood. This is diagnostic. If you find this, especially on a tree that's declining or you know, doing very poorly, then it tells you you have oak root rot fungus, or Armillaria mellea is the species we have in Southern California. And then what do you do about it? Well, if the tree's in poor condition and too far gone, then you just force to remove the tree. You really can't save it. If the tree's healthy still and hasn't really been affected too much, then you can try and dry it out, and especially if it's a tree that might be have some resistance. Actually, our California coastline oak and most of our oaks are fairly resistant. They've grown in association with this fungus for thousands of years, and that's pretty typical that they reach a balance. Now, our dry summer actually inhibits this fungus. So if you've heard not to water your oaks during the summer, don't water underneath native oaks in the summer, it's because of this fungus. If you keep the soil wet during the summer months, if you put a lawn under a native oak and water it two or three times a week during the summer, you're going to, this fungus is going to grow rapidly, and you're going to see the tree go into pretty rapid decline, usually within about 2, 3, or 5 years. You'll get a thinning of the canopy and a tip dieback, and instead of standing under the tree and looking up and not seeing any sky, you'll look up and see most of the sky, and then the tree is now you're kind of forced to just cut it down, because if you don't, it'll fall down. It may not fall down tomorrow, but it'll probably fall down in some relatively short period of time, in the next 5 to 10 years. And rather than play a guessing game of when the tree is going to fall, especially if it's close to a building or close to where there's a lot of foot traffic and there's some little hazard there, then you're forced to cut the tree down. Of course, when you replant with a resistant species. Now, Armillaria can survive in a stump for 50 to 100 years. Once it gets a hold of that stump, no other fungi will really colonize it. There's no real significant colonization. And it will live in the large roots that long as well, for decades. So in order to try and control it, you remove the stump and you remove as many large roots as possible. Any roots over 2 inches, that gets to be a pretty difficult task on a large tree. Remove all the roots over 2 inches. So you're going to remove the stump and as many large roots as possible, and then replant with a resistant tree species some distance away from where that tree was. You don't want to plant in the exact same hole. If you really want another oak, you might consider the southern live oak, Quercus virginiana, that apparently has some pretty good resistance, probably better resistance than our native oaks, than like the California coastline oak, or perhaps an Engelmann oak or a valley oak, something like that. But, I would actually encourage you to maybe consider one of our natives over the southern live oak, although the southern live oak is a beautiful oak tree. So that's the oak root rot fungus. Now, as I said, it can get on a lot of different trees. And, when you're dealing with oak root rot, anything in the rose family tends to be highly susceptible. So beech trees will often die within a year or two of getting infected, whereas native oaks can survive for 100 years with the infection on the root system, as long as you're not watering them in the summer months. So if you keep them dry during the summer, your oaks, even though they're infected, can survive for many, many decades. And that's what you're trying to do. You're trying to manage the disease because you're not going to eradicate it. The other thing to take to know is that the okra root fungus doesn't exist uniformly in the soil. It's primarily just in the root system of the tree. It's not really free living in the soil. And it occupies acres, not just a little corner of your yard. So if you have it on a tree in your garden, in your backyard, front yard, it's likely to be across the entire block you live on, if not many blocks. If you fly over a forest and look at some of these areas that are the trees are being killed, there are these huge circles that can be 50 to 100 acres where all the trees are being killed by Armillaria. And of course, as I mentioned, there are more than one species. We have Armillaria mellia, but if you go to Colorado or you go to some of the other forests across the western United States or even the eastern United States, they have different species, and they're not necessarily as virulent as ours. Armillaria mellia that we have in Southern California is considered highly virulent, and it has a very broad host range. So I've seen it kill just about every tree you can think of. Now, geckos are considered nearly immune, and the edible fig, we have the mission fig, is, I think, immune. And then I think Bergmansia, as I mentioned, I think that's nearly immune. But citrus will get it. The swamp fruits get it really bad. I've even seen it on iris, so I've seen it on a lot of stuff. And good on strawberry, too. So the host range is quite large. So that's the oak root rot fungus. Let's see if I have any notes on oak root rot. Okay, let's talk about a more modern epidemic that's affecting California and, again, affecting our native oaks. And it's called sudden oak death. Down here in Southern California, we don't hear about it too often, but up in the Bay Area, this is big news. It has been big news since about 1995. So, in 1995, it was observed up in like Marin County, Santa Cruz County, so the Bay Area and the coastal mountains, a large number of oak trees, native oaks. First started with tan oaks and black oaks. Now, tan oak is not a true oak, although some people would move it into the Quercus genus. It's Lithocarpus, and so it's a sister genus, although it's very, very closely related to oak. And perhaps it should be considered an oak, but the common name is tan oak. They were getting infected. California black oak was getting infected, and the California coastline oak was getting infected. There's another species up in the Bay Area called Shreve's oak that became another host oak. All of these are black oaks or red oaks. There are three different groups of oaks that are native to California. They're black or red. That's the same group. And then there are white oaks and there are golden oaks. The white oaks and the golden oaks are not susceptible to sudden oak death. So the valley oak, Quercus lobata, cannot become infected, whereas the California coastline oak, Quercus agrifolia, is one of the more common trees killed by this. And the other thing that's important is that this disease currently is only reported in 14 counties in California and one county in Oregon in terms of being out in the woodland killing oak trees in an oak woodland. So we've never found it on an oak tree in Southern California. The farthest south is San Luis Obispo County. Santa Cruz County. San Luis Obispo County has not reported oak trees infected with sudden oak death. The pathogen is called Phytophthora morum. That's the actual organism that causes the disease. And it's an interesting disease for several reasons. On oaks, it's a canker disease. Again, another canker. Much like chestnut blight or Dutch. Well, Dutch elm disease was a vascular disease. The fungus grew in the xylem or the wood of the tree and it wilted and then that would kill the tree. Chestnut blight was a canker. This is a canker. The Phytophthora morum infects the bark of the tree and then you get an area on the bark that turns a little brownish or it cracks and it sinks a little and it gums and it bleeds. So it's a bleeding canker. And it's a black gooey material that oozes out of the trunk. And let's take a look at some pictures of sudden oak death. Let's first look at number 12. Bring this up. And you can see this is, I think, Chinacamp State Park up in Marin County. And you can see all these dead trees in here. All this dead tree. All these were oaks that were killed And now the pines are doing fine. They are not host, so they're okay. But it does cause a bleeding canker. And if we go to photograph number 13, we'll take a look at the canker itself on a California coastline oak. And I'll take a drink of water. This is the bleeding canker. And this is where the bark is infected. And then it oozes this black goo out of the cankers. And if you cut into the bark, let's take a look at 14 real quick, and let's bring that up. Cut into the bark, and this is where it's infected. This is the infected area, and this is the healthy bark in here. And if you take a little piece of this, you can culture the Phytophthora right out of it. Phytophthora morum is the pathogen. And this can actually move a little. It's really a bark disease. It doesn't get very deep in the tree, maybe a millimeter or two in the xylem, the sapwood. And then it can run up and come back out farther up on the tree. I see we have another caller. Let's go to our next caller. George, calling from Eagle Rock. You're on the air.
Yeah, hi, Gerald. I wanted to ask you a question. I have not cut my roses until just yesterday. So that's probably able to pick them cutting from the roses. Is it too late or is it okay?
It's okay. The advice that I give on roses is I kind of parrot the advice I've gotten from the rose curator at the Huntington Botanical Gardens. Claire Martin is the rose curator at the Huntington. And his pruning window is December 15th to February 15th. So this is actually an excellent time to prune your roses. We prune them to force them into dormancy. Typically, you prune them down up to about knee height or shin height and to about four canes.
Okay.
And this is the perfect time to do it. So you're not too late at all. You're right in the, you know, this is optimum. Okay. Maybe this is more cold weather. They're really good.
Okay, so they're 2 months from December 15th to February 15th, right?
That's the best time to prune them.
Okay, good.
And what happens when you prune your roses back like that, these are shrub roses, they're not climbers?
No, shrub roses.
Yeah, the shrubbers. You know, because you really usually let the climbers go, depending on how big you want to let them get. But by doing that, by putting them back like that, you force them into dormancy. You also want to pick off any leaves. So there's, you defoliate the whole thing, you clean up all the leaves around it and put them in the trash.
Okay.
Because there's two diseases that you know are common on roses, powdery mildew and rust.
Yes, yes.
And the powdery mildew, there's not a lot you can do about that in terms of just getting rid of the leaves. That's not going to help so much with the powdery mildew. But it will help with the rust. To get rid of any leaves that have fallen under the rose bushes, clean that all out, and that'll help a little bit with the rust, especially in the spring.
Yeah, I've noticed that there's some, there's two types of like a mildew. There's the black powdery mildew and also the white one.
Well, the powdery mildew on roses is white. If you're seeing black on the leaves, that might be black spot. That's a different disease.
Okay.
And powdery mildew can look different on different hosts, but on roses, it's going to be a white furry growth on the top of the leaf. It's really overcast and damp and wet in the spring, and it really gets going. It'll grow all over the buds. It'll be all over the canes. It can really get bad. There are a couple of really nice ways to control the powdery mildew, and since we're talking about roses briefly here. You can either spray them with milk and water at about anywhere from 10% milk up to 50% milk. And I was talking to somebody the other day who's tried it, and everyone reports back that that works. But she went with non-fat milk, and she said it didn't smell as much. She got a little smell from the milk, because, you know, it gets kind of sour.
Yes.
And actually, that souring is what controls the powdery mildew. When the milk, you know, gets colonized by microbes, you know, by bacteria and fungi, those bacteria and fungi inhibit the powdery mildew fungus. The milk itself doesn't do it. So the other thing is that there are now potassium bicarbonate products, fungicides that are organic, labeled organic. Potassium bicarbonate is non-toxic. It doesn't hurt mammals at all. So, and you can purchase potassium bicarbonate registered fungicides. I know Kellogg has a product that's potassium bicarbonate, and that's very effective. Now, typically you do have to spray fairly frequently, maybe once a week or even maybe once every 10 days, and then avoid overhead irrigation.
Oh, okay.
See, because if you water on top, then it splashes spores all over the place. So, overhead irrigation almost always makes foliar diseases worse.
Especially at night.
Well, typically you want to water early in the morning, right before dawn.
Okay.
If you water at night and get the leaves wet at night, they stay wet longer.
And it'll probably increase the possibility of mildew. And
it can create more problems for you. So usually you want to water the soil rather than the leaves. Now, occasionally you can wash the plant off to wash off dust. That's fine, especially if you're in a very dusty environment, because dust is a problem too. But I would do that late in the afternoon or mid-afternoon, and then the foliage would probably dry off before nightfall.
Yeah, I heard that if you water the plants and the roses when it's really sunny, during the midday, it tends to burn the leaves and the flowers. Is that correct?
Well, if you get the flowers wet, it can brown the edges. The flowers will suffer from that. The foliage, if it's really hot out, that may occur. In the spring, that shouldn't be a problem, but you do want to avoid getting the buds or the flowers wet themselves. In general, you don't want to overhead irrigate. But I know if you've got a real dust problem, the dust itself is a problem because it inhibits beneficial insects that eat things like aphids and mealybugs and scale, So, it's a trade-off. I would probably wash the dust off once a month, something like that. That wouldn't be too big a problem in terms of, the problem would be if you're overhead irrigating frequently, like once or twice a week. Then you really...
Gerald, as far as the dwarf trees, the fruit trees, the dwarf fruit trees, is it also a proper time now to cut them down to prune them?
Yes, this is when you prune. Storm fruits, peaches, nectarines, plums, apricots, all those prunus, they're all in the genus Prunus, and you want to prune them, you prune them hard, you remove nearly 60% of the wood, and there's a wonderful video that you can watch showing how to prune peach trees. It's at the University of Massachusetts Fruit Tree Advisor. So if you go to Google or go to YouTube and put in Massachusetts Fruit Tree Advisor, you can find that video.
Okay.
And I've shown it before on the show. So really, it's about a 5-minute clip that shows how to prune fruit trees, or peach trees particularly. But on the stone fruits, normally you prune them in an open center technique. You take out the center of the tree and you develop four major scaffolds at about hip height. And then every winter you go in and you prune out nearly 60% of the wood. And that will generate a lot of new growth, and the new growth flowers and produces more fruit.
I wanted to ask you, will you be showing in the next segment more propagating? Because you showed something about propagating a few months ago, and I recorded it. But I would be interested in learning more, and maybe I can record some of that.
Well, that's a good suggestion. I probably should have a whole show just on propagation. If you go to people who study horticulture, if you go to Cal Poly Pomona and get a degree in horticulture, or any of the schools that have degrees in horticulture, they have a whole 30-hour course on propagation. So it is a good subject. I've just kind of brushed the sides of it generally, and never really concentrated on plant propagation. But there's a wide variety of ways to propagate plants, from seeds to cuttings to grafting, to tissue culture. All these mechanisms for propagating plants, and it's a lot of fun to grow your own plants. I do a lot of it myself, especially cuttings and grafting.
Yes, that's what I'm interested in, grafting.
Okay, well, then I'll do a grafting demonstration coming up in the next few weeks.
Thank you. I'll record that.
Okay.
Thank you very much. I really appreciate all your information.
Okay, good luck with your garden. Thank you for your call. Okay, let's talk a little bit more about sudden oak death. And then we want to go to a little video clip talking about sudden oak death. So it started in 95. For 5 years, people weren't sure what was killing the oaks. They knew they were dying in high numbers. They formed a task force, or I should say, a task force was formed called the California Oak Mortality Task Force to look into what was killing the oaks. There were a lot of ideas about what was killing the oaks. In 2000, though, they cultured from the cankers and they cultured out a new species of Phytophthora. Now, Phytophthora is a water mold. It was historically considered to be a fungus, but it's really not a fungus. It's really a parasitic algae, and the whole group, the whole water mold group, are parasitic algae. This one was really quite unusual. It was a new species that had never been seen before. And on oaks, it causes these bleeding cankers, which get bigger and bigger and bigger and girdle the tree, and then the tree dies because you've killed the back of the canopy, which is right underneath the bark. And if you do that all the way around the tree, it will kill the tree. There's another set of plants that get infected by Phytophthora morum, and those are leaf spot hosts. So you got the oaks that are canker hosts, and you got everything else, which is leaf spots. So that would be things like camellias, rhododendrons, kalmia, which people don't grow in Southern California. A lot of things in the heath family, the Ericaceae, or the order, the heath order Ericaceae. It also includes toyon and viburnum, Magnolia grandiflora and Magnolia slatigiana. So several magnolias are hosts. The California bay, which is Umbellifera californica, that's our native bay, actually plays a very important role in the disease. The sweet bay, which is Laurus nobilis, that's the one we use for cooking. That's also a host. So a lot of these are in nursery production, and it was found in 2004. We found it on the camellias at Monrovia Nursery up in Azusa. It was a big deal, and by the end of 2004, there was a federal emergency order restricting the movement of nursery stock in California, Oregon, Washington, because nurseries in all three states have been found with infected plants, plants infected by Phytophthora morum. And now you cannot ship out of California, Oregon, or Washington unless the nursery is inspected annually and found to be free of sudden oak death or Phytophthora morum, the actual pathogen. They also, in 2004-2005, not only did we do a national survey of nurseries in the United States, a survey of all of Europe was done. It was found in every country in Europe in nursery production. They found infected plants in nurseries. So this pathogen, Phytophthora morum, was in nursery production for decades and decades and decades. It clearly was. It didn't get on the oaks until sometime in the early 1990s. And then once it started killing oaks, it became really important because oaks are important. Although you'd be hard to convince the California, the Los Angeles County Department of Public Works that oaks are important. They're more than willing to cut them down. So we have a federal quarantine, we have a state quarantine for Phytophthora morum. And here's the interesting thing about this. This is a foliar disease. Most Phytophthora diseases are root rots. And Phytophthora root rot is a really important disease for many, many plants, including agricultural crops and in landscapes. But Phytophthora morum is not particularly a root rot, although some people who work on Phytophthora believe that all Phytophthora will cause root rot. This clearly is a foliar disease. It infects the bark on oaks and infects the leaves on other hosts. And what is the point I wanted to make? Is that the California Bay is a leaf spot host, and the leaves get infected. So the California Bay is a big tree. There's 30, 40-foot trees, and they're next to an oak. And those leaves are infected with the pathogen. And they spores on the leaf, and in the spring, when it's rainy and windy, the spores are blown onto the adjacent oak, and the spores land on the bark and infect the bark. And the funny thing is, the leaves don't get infected on our oaks, just the bark, whereas the leaves are infected on all the other hosts, the non-canker hosts. So it's an interesting biology. It's a little quirky. The leaves of things like camellias have to be wet for a minimum of 12 hours to get infected. That happens all the time in nursery production, especially in the winter when it rains. After the 2004 breakout at Monrovia Nursery and the federal order restricting the movement of nursery stock from California, Oregon, Washington, then all the nurseries that export out of Los Angeles County had to be inspected. I actually run that program for Los Angeles County Commissioner's Office. I inspect about anywhere from 80 to 90 nurseries every winter looking for Phytophthora morum. We're required to collect 40 samples minimum. Sometimes we collect more than 100. And we send those up. I usually collect from all those nurseries, I'll do about 4,500 samples. And for the first few years after that, we regularly had nurseries that were positive for Phytophthora morum, usually on chameleon. Roughly 90% of all the plants found to be infected with Phytophthora morum in nurseries in California have been chameleons. Chameleons are the number one nursery host in California. We don't find it out on chameleons out in the landscape. We only find it in nurseries where they crowd the plants together and they overhead irrigate. You really have to set up a microclimate that will support the disease, and nurseries do that. So we find it in nursery production. Now, for the last 2 years, I have not had a positive nursery. That's the good news. And it's not good for a nursery to be positive because they have to destroy the plants that are infected. And in some cases, that actually ends up being quite a few plants, and a very expensive thing for them to do. Let me say that there's some other things that are interesting. You know, there are 14 counties that are infested in California, and Kern County in Oregon, which is right on the border with California. And up there, it's on tan oaks. I never really cared when the tan oaks were dying, because tan oaks are considered almost a junk tree species. But once they started killing black oaks and California coastal oaks, then people really started jumping up and down about this disease. It doesn't seem, you know, to be moving any farther south. That's really good news. And it doesn't seem to move any farther into Oregon in terms of getting on trees in the woodland. Of course, every year we find it in different nurseries in Oregon, Washington, Canada, California. They find it in nurseries in Georgia, Florida, all of the United States. I guess they look forth there too. So we'd like to go to a little clip here, a little video clip. And this is about sudden oak death. It is a long clip, but we're just going to show a little bit of it. And it's going to show some of the coastal mountain areas where sudden oak death is decimating and killing the California coastal oaks and the California black oaks. Let's go to that clip.
A silent, efficient killer was found in California's scenic coastline. Discovered in Marin County in 1995, it strikes without warning, and now has been found as far south as Big Sur in Monterey County, and as far north as northern Sonoma County. Eventually, scientists fear that it could imperil up to 1,500 miles of California and Oregon coast. The killer is a new pathogen that attacks at least three species of oak trees, coast live oak, black oak, and shrieves oak, and a species that is closely related to oaks called tan oak. These trees generally thrive in California's coastal foothills, as well as many other locations throughout the state. Because of their widespread ecological, aesthetic, and often economic contributions to the environment, the large-scale and expanding range of dying oak trees is becoming a major concern among homeowners, land managers, and public agencies. Oaks are aesthetically pleasing in the landscape, where they contribute to soil stability and water quality. They are treasured by homeowners and add to property values. Oak woodlands are also highly valued by recreationalists, and they provide food and shelter for numerous wildlife species. In fact, they provide habitat for more than half of our terrestrial vertebrates. The large number of dead oaks and tan oaks in coastal areas is also creating large amounts of fuel for wildfire, a perennial California nemesis. University of California horticulturist Pavel Spira was the first to notice the dead and dying oaks. He gave the problem its name, sudden oak death, or SOD.
Well, I gave name to this disease, sudden oak death, mainly because when you see first symptoms, the actual progression of the foliar manifestation is very rapid. So the tree will have a rather light green or slightly browning foliage, but very soon, within 6 to 8 weeks, the foliage changes to brown. So because the sudden change in foliage, I call it sudden oak death.
Since Spira's discovery of sudden oak death, UC researchers have been scrambling to find the cause of the problem. Initially, insects, disease, pollution, and other environmental disturbances were all suspect. The first breakthrough came when researcher David Rizzo found a new disease organism in the tissue of the dead and dying trees. Although related to some 60 other types of pathogens from the genus Phytophthora that caused a variety of problems with agricultural crops, this particular strain had never been seen before in the United States. Another form of Phytophthora was responsible for the Irish potato blight in the 1840s. And while this pathogen is technically classified as a type of water mold, it is frequently referred to by researchers as a fungus due to its fungus-like properties.
What we see here, the earliest symptoms of the disease on a coast larva is bleeding that comes directly out of the bark, where the pathogen has entered through the bark and is killing the tissue directly inside the tree. And the bleeding is sort of the host's way of trying to kick the fungus back out. In this case, it doesn't do a particularly good job of it. So here you have a tree at the really advanced stages of infection. You can see the typical bleeding symptom of infection by Phytophthora. But at these later stages, as more and more of the bark is killed by the fungus, we see evidence of various types of bark beetles and ambrosia beetles that will move in and burrow into the bark, burrow into the wood. And you can see examples of boring dust that are left by the beetles as they enter into the tree. Usually the beetles will attack the spots that are bleeding, so the areas that have been killed by the pathogen. Potentially they can expand out and hit other areas of the tree, but mostly they are hitting the areas that are already infected by Phytophthora. The role?
So that was Dave Rizzo. And Dave is a professor in the plant pathology department at UC Davis. And in 2000, he isolated Phytophthora from those cankers. And then about a year later, they published the name Phytophthora morum. But one thing that also occurred was there were visiting scientists from Europe who looked at it and said, hey, you know, this is the same Phytophthora we're getting off of rhododendrons and viburnum in Holland and Germany. We didn't get it as early as 1993. So that's when the connection with a nursery leaf spot disease on a fairly small set of plants, mostly rhododendrons and camellias and some others. That's when that connection was made, and that's, you know, I've kind of covered the whole story to some extent. But, we're not going to control a disease that occurs in forests. You cannot stop a disease or an insect pest from sweeping through a forest. There's just there's not enough money, and if you have the money, it's really it wouldn't work anyway. You'd have to, the amount of money would be phenomenal. So that's the story on sudden oak death. And I'll talk more about Phytophthora in a later show. But let me talk about a couple other diseases, particularly the next disease I want to talk about is Pierce's disease of grape and the scorch diseases. This is really one disease and many different hosts. Now, Pierce's disease of grape was first observed in the 1890s in the Anaheim area along the Santa Ana River. It was known then as the grape mystery disease or Anaheim disease. And a plant pathologist from USDA named Pierce came and worked on it. And after that, it became known as Pierce's disease of grape. He believed it was a virus. And then there was evidence in the 1940s and through the years that this was a bacterial disease. They treated it with antibiotics. They saw some remission. It wasn't curative, but it helped a little bit. And then in the late 1970s, they isolated a bacteria from the infected grapes, and the name of that bacteria is Xylella fastidiosa. And Xylella lives inside the xylem. The xylem is the water-conducting tissue of the plant. It is moved from plant to plant by a vector, and the vectors are sharpshooters. Sharpshooters are types of leafhopper. And we have a lot of native sharpshooters. The native sharpshooters are like the blue-green sharpshooter and the red-headed sharpshooter. And this has been a big problem for grapes, especially in hot inland areas. It's not so bad in cool coastal areas because what happens is the bacteria reproduces inside the xylem and clogs it up, and the plant basically dies for lack of water. And so the symptoms are very similar to drought. The plant wilts, and the leaves turn brown. So if you can take a look at, let's take a look at number 23, Xylella on white grape. Let's bring that up full screen. And you can see the typical symptoms. This is what we call marginal necrosis, or burning on the edges. This is, that's pretty typical on grape, and this is white grape. And if you look at the next one, Xylella on red grape, you can see on red grape, you get this red margin next to the scorch. So here's the scorch center, and then there's a red band right there. And you see that on red grapes. Now, the other things that it does to the plant is it stunts it, and eventually it will kill it. It's a fatal disease. So you can see this picture behind me. Here's an infected plant. This is one that's probably not infected, and the shoots are taken off in the spring. And this one's stunted and with poor growth. And it takes about 5 years or so for a plant to die from it. The other thing to see on grape, if we look at number 26, is that you get an uneven maturation of the bark on the new canes. So here you get these brown patches up here, and then you get green patches here. That's a symptom of Xylella or Pierce's disease. And then also, when the leaves fall off, they leave the petiole still on here. So here's a petiole. I think that's a petiole. And the leaf has fallen off. And the petioles stay on the branches. We're going to look at a couple of the sharpshooters. Let's look at 27. We'll look at the blue-green sharpshooter. And this is a native sharpshooter, Southern California. And then let's take a look at number 28. This is the red-headed sharpshooter. There's also a smoke-free sharpshooter. But then in 1990, we had this one introduced, number 29. Let's take a look at this picture. This is the glassy-winged sharpshooter, Gliss. Now, glassy-winged sharpshooter is native all the way from Florida to Texas. And in 1990, they were discovered in Orange County. But when they found them, guess what? There were millions of them. They've been there for a while. And also at the same time, oleanders started dying out in the Palm Springs area. It was a year or so, or maybe a couple, and it was discovered that the oleanders were dying. They were infected with Xylella. And it turns out that when those sharpshooters were introduced from the south, they actually came from Texas. We know by genetics that the classic sharpshooters we have in California are from Texas. That they brought a new strain of Xylella with them that was capable of infecting oleander. And now the oleanders are dying by millions all over Southern California. And glassy winged sharpshooter is established all over Southern California. And the sharpshooters themselves don't do a lot of damage. But what they do is acquire the bacteria from an infected plant and move it to another plant. Now, it's a fatal disease. There's no chemical control. There's not a lot you can do about it. Once the plant's infected, you might as well cut it down and replant it with something that's not a host. The host list, though, unfortunately, is growing. We now have four different strains in Southern California. We have the Pierce's disease strain, the oleander strain, we have an almond leaf scorch strain, and we have a mulberry strain. So, and it's getting into a lot of our landscape materials. It's getting into olive, a liquid amber, it's oleander, of course, pregnotal, liquid amber, so it's killing a lot of stuff. If we bring this up full screen, you can see here's a dead oleander bush. Here's one that is probably infected but has enough symptoms. Here's another dead one. So that's the story on oleanders. I wouldn't recommend you grow them. They're going downhill fast. I have another fatal disease, but we're running out of time. We're down to our last few minutes. I want to mention that all our shows are archived on YouTube. So if you didn't tape the show and today we didn't have a demonstration. And I will do a graphene demonstration in the next few weeks for people who are interested in graphene or propagation. But you'll be able to, you can go to YouTube and just put Gardens of California and you can watch the show. If you've already seen it once, you probably won't need to do that. And now let me show you a little book and pull something up here. I'm going to pull up some plants real quick. Talansias. These are talansias. I love talansias. They're so much fun. Talansias are air plants, and there's many different species. And there's a wonderful book on talansias, and this is it. Let's take a quick look at it. And this is by Paul Isley. And Paul has a nursery down in Torrance called the Rainforest Flora. And he grows bromelias and talansias. And talansias are great fun. And you can tie them onto a piece of wood. They don't have any roots. They're air plants. And you just mix them. This is a talansia. And this is a talansia. These are bromelias. Talansias are bromelias. And this was actually a gift to me from my son for Christmas because he knows I'm kind of a nut about plants. And they have really fun flowers, and they last a long time. So I just wanted to, I brought them in. I thought I was going to use them if I didn't have enough lecture material. So I think we're running out of time. I want to thank everyone who watched the show and called in. We'll be here again next week. So I hope to see you then. If you have anything you want to comment on your garden, give us a call. And I'd love to hear from you and love to help you out with your garden. Good luck in your garden. And have a good time in your garden.